Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. It's such a wonderful place. It's great to see so many sympathetic geometers here. So I fully expect in sort of 2 or 3 weeks' time to see lots of joint papers appearing on the archive as a result of all this. So I'm going to talk about some joint work with Ivan Smith about Lagrangian cell complexes and Markov numbers. So I want to start with a bit of philosophy. I hope you excuse it. So the basic underlying idea of all this is if you have an algebraic projective variety, so let's say X inside CPN, this is a symplectic manifold. It's a smooth algebraic variety. This is a symplectic manifold with the pullback Fibonacci form. And you can ask how much of the symplectic topology, or how much of the algebraic geometry of this variety is remembered by the symplectic topology, just the Fibonacci form. If you throw away everything else, how much does that remember? And the answer is, well, obviously not everything, because you can deform the variety and change it, but you don't change the symplectic form by Moser isotopy. So you can at best get at some sort of deformation invariance of this variety. So, for example, you can compute the Gromov-Witten invariance this way. But what I want to focus on is this sort of this other idea that if you have a variety over here and you can deform it, eventually it can develop some singularities over here. And the variety over there, I claim, already knew about these singularities because, you know, in the simplest example, if you develop a node, then we know that there's this vanishing cycle, this Lagrangian sphere that gets collapsed down under the symplectic parallel transport map in this family to that node. So let me write something on a board. So if xt is a family of projective varieties, such that x0 is singular, that some subset of x, let's say x1, gets crushed by a symplectic parallel transport. Singularity, and we call this the vanishing cycle. Okay, so we're hopefully familiar with this example where you take a nodal degeneration, and when you smooth it out, you get a Lagrangian sphere in the smoothing. Okay, so I want to focus on some singularities that are not just nodes today. So first of all, I'm going to tell you what the vanishing cycle looks like, then I'm going to tell you what the singularity is and why it's important, and then I'm going to tell you what we can actually prove about them. Now I've got to navigate these boards. So this one is... Okay, so here's the Lagrangian submanifold, and it's not a manifold at all. So if I say submanifold, please excuse me, it's some sort of singular thing. So, a P pinwheel is a two-dimensional cell complex and you can just define it with a picture like this. Okay, so I'm subdividing the boundary of the circle into P arcs and I'm going to draw arrows on those arcs to indicate that I'm identifying them. So the usual picture for RP2 is this one. So this is the P equals 2 pinwheel is RP2. This is the P equals 3 pinwheel. And this one's a manifold. This one isn't, because if I take one of these points, you know, there's two other points here and here that get identified to the same thing. And I can go back into the disk, into the interior of the disk in three different ways. Whereas if it was a manifold, there'd only be two different ways to go in. So locally near this circle, this thing, the cell complex, looks a bit like this. It's a circle with three flanges coming in and intersecting along this circle. So this is the local model for the singularities of this cell complex. P does not have to be a prime number. It's just a number, an integer. Okay, so I'm going to talk about Lagrangian pinwheels, and it's not completely clear what I mean by a Lagrangian pinwheel because this is not a submanifold. Right, so I have to tell you what they mean. Sorry. A Lagrangian pinwheel is an immersion from the disk into some symplectic manifold X such that pi star of omega is zero, and such that I restricted to the interior of the disk is an embedding and I guess I want the image to actually look like this. So the image is homeomorphic to a pinwheel. Okay, so although we have singularity, just think of this as being parameterized by a disk, this disk, and the symplectic form vanishes on the disk. Okay, so is it clear what kind of objects I'm talking about?
So it is equivalent to say that I induce this like continuous map on that pinwheel image.
Yes, yeah, certainly, yeah. But in particular, I want it to be a smooth immersion on the interior of the disk, so that I can talk about the Lagrangian property. Okay, so this is the Lagrangian we're interested in. I claim it's the vanishing cycle of some singularity.
Is that a question? X a four manifold? So otherwise it will be like
yeah, absolutely. So it's going to be a singularity of an algebraic surface, complex algebraic surface. Yeah, obviously, you know, there are many other singularities in high dimensions and they'll have interesting vanishing cycles too. But all I want to talk about is this one. So, this is the vanishing cycle of what's called a Weyl singularity. Which is a surface singularity where, as Igor says, surface means four-manifold and it's a quotient singularity, it's a quotient of C2 by some finite group action and the action, it's an action of the p-roots of unity, sorry, the p-squared roots of unity. Okay, so I have this cyclic group of order p squared, and it's going to act as follows. So x, y is going to go to mu of x, mu to the q of y. So this q has nothing to do with which group we're dividing by, but it tells us which action we're using, and we'll get different singularities for different q's. I should say q and p are coprime. Okay, so I claim that if you take this singularity and you smooth it out a little bit, you're going to introduce some kind of Lagrangian core, which is this thing.
So you need smoothing control?
Say again?
So you need smoothing
control? Yes. For this singularity, yes. yeah, in general, that's a very good question. In this case, it's also a good question, but the answer is yes. Right, so let me say something about this. So the Milner fibre of this singularity, I'm going to call BPQ. So this has some nice properties. It's a Stein domain. Which retracts onto a Lagrangian copy of the pinwheel. So it's skeleton. which I'm going to call L plus Q, is a peeping wheel. Its boundary, which I'm going to call sigma PQ, is a Lens space. So it's some sort of contact hypersurface. So the main important point is that the rational homology of this guy is the same as the rational homology of a ball. Q in degree 0 and 0 otherwise. Okay, so that means this is kind of a nice manifold if you're, say, a low-dimensional topologist and you're interested in constructing smooth four manifolds that are maybe exotic or something with small Betti numbers, because if you have some region you can cut out and replace with this, then you're probably going to decrease the Betti numbers because this has no Betti numbers. So they come up a lot in four manifold theory for that reason. They come up a lot in algebraic geometry because there's this. So if you look at the moduli space of general type surfaces, this is not a compact thing because they can develop singularities, but if you allow them to develop certain kinds of singularities called semi-log canonical singularities, then you get a compact moduli space. And these are the kind of singularities that get introduced at that point. So this is this Collard-Shepard-Baron compactification of the moduli space of general type surfaces. So they arise very, very naturally in the context of compactifying moduli spaces of algebraic surfaces. Okay, are there any questions about any?
Are the two P's the same?
Which P's?
This Q is a P pinwheel.
Yes. Yes, this P is the P here, and this Q is just some other number. And this should make you slightly confused because this is the same cell complex for all Q. You know, this doesn't depend on Q. So these are different local models for a neighborhood of one of these pinwheels. So there's, you know, for a smooth manifold smooth Lagrangian submanifold in a neighborhood, it's always going to look like the cotangent bundle of that submanifold, right? The Weinstein neighborhood theorem. So here we're saying, well, there are many local models, one for each sort of Q between 1 and P that's co-prime to P, so like this Euler-Totient function. But that's it. Okay, so let me write this next. So it's a theorem of Khodorkovsky that these are the only neighborhoods. So. So any Lagrangian pinwheel, let's say P pinwheel, is contained in a symplectically embedded BPQ of some volume, right? You can sort of retract and expand this thing, so you're allowed to do that, for some Q. And the Q is determined by somehow the, in this picture of, in this picture near the circle where the thing is singular, there's some winding number relative to a symplectic trivialization of the tangent bundle along this circle, of how these sort of Lagrangian flanges wind as you move around that circle. There's some sort of integer winding number which only depends on its residue mod p. So that's what this q is. It's some sort of tangent data about how these tangent planes come in along that singular circle. Okay, so we have some finite list of local models, sort of one for every q between 1 and p that's co-prime to p. So if you don't like singular Lagrangian submanifolds, you can just think everything I'm saying is really about symplectic embeddings of this submanifold. Co-dimension 0. Okay, so...
I have a question.
Yes.
So you have like an order of, like, if you just take a... I'm confused. I mean, so the point is that there's no natural ordering on the way they come in because it's a four-dimensional picture, so...
Yes.
You can't just look at the order in which you go around the disk and get some kind of permutation of the flanges because it's a four-dimensional...
Exactly, yeah. So you can think these different cues correspond to... right, so in this disk picture, if I draw a circle that's centered on the center of the disk, this, and I draw it in this picture, it's going to do this. But it could have also done this. So it could do that route in either order. So there's some sort of monodromies. You come off this end and come back this end, and the cue is telling you exactly how much to rotate this end to glue it back to this end. That's one way of thinking about it. Yeah, any other questions? Okay. So I want to give you another picture of this space BPQ, just to sort of convince you that everything I've said is true. So, well, also, if you want to play with this thing for yourself, then this is a nice description. Okay, so I'm going to start with another description of the singularity, which is I'm going to start with the AP minus 1 Milner fiber. In other words, well, sorry, the AP minus 1 singularity. So this is going to be XY minus Z to the P equals. I'm just going to start with the Milner fiber, equals 1. Okay, so this is a smooth surface. Forget about the singularity. Okay, this is a smooth surface. This is just the well-known AP minus 1 Milner fiber. You can think about this, you know, visually you can sort of imagine what it looks like as a projection down to C, projecting onto the Z-coordinate. And that's a Lefschetz vibration. It's got singularities, so that the fiber over each point is like XY equals a constant, which is a conic. And then whenever Z to the P is 1, the fibre is just a pair of lines. So you end up with this kind of Lefschetz vibration picture of the disk with P singularities living over the prefix of unity. Okay.
What am I moving now? These two?
Okay, so I can also deform this variety, and by, you know, setting 1 equal to epsilon and then letting epsilon go to 0, and then I'll get a singular variety. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide AP minus 1 by an action of Z mod P. And on the singularity, what happens then if I divide by that group action is I get the Wahl singularity. So that means this thing is going to be BPQ. So I just need to tell you what this group action is. Well, it's going to send x, y, z to mu x, mu inverse y, and then mu to the q z. Okay, so this is, now you think of this as an action of the p-throughs of unity. And you can see this action preserves that equation, right? Mu and mu inverse cancel in x, y, and then mu to the q to the p is 1. So this action preserves this subvariety of C3, and its quotient, it's a free action, its quotient is this Stein manifold BPQ. And what happens to this Lefschetz vibration? Can you still see that? Not really. It doesn't go any further. Okay, so we have this Lefschetz vibration for the AP minus 1 with these three singularities. And now when I take the quotient, you know, we're acting on Z by a p-throughs of unity. So we rotate the base by a p-throughs of unity. So actually this new guy also has a Lefschetz vibration, But now with just one singularity, because all the singularities get identified under this group action. But something funny happens, because this action has a fixed point here, at the origin. So over here, what we end up with is a multiple fibre over the origin. In other words, a fibre that's kind of sent to itself by the group action. It's still a free action on that fibre, but it's so this is now a multiple fibre. Okay, so what I want to show you is how to see the pinwheel in this picture. Any guesses? You could do some audience participation. Can anyone see a nice Lagrangian submanifold of this? Or a pinwheel?
I think it connects the logical fibre in.
Yeah, okay. So if I draw an arc like this, there's a vanishing cycle coming out of this guy, which is a Lagrangian disk. And as that comes into the multiple fibre, that circle is getting mapped down to this multiple fibre p times, sort of a p to 1 cover. So this innocuous looking green line is actually the projection of a Lagrangian pinwheel. LPQ. So that's how to see that this pinwheel is really the core of this smoothing, the skeleton. Right, okay, so if you want to know more about these BPQs, there's a nice paper by Metzeli and Vedansky, where they prove, for example, these things contain no exact Lagrangian submanifolds, so they're quite interesting manifolds. Okay, so I want to state our theorem now, because it's gone too long without stating a theorem. Here's the theorem. So remember, I started off with this bit of philosophy saying, somehow the vanishing cycles in the smooth thing should tell you about the degenerations of the variety. So I want to focus on the simplest case of a variety in four dimensions, so CP2. So suppose you've got sort of LP1 up to LPN. So you've got N disjoint, pairwise disjoint Lagrangian pinwheels in CP2. So this is sort of asking what kind of degenerations of CP2 can I get that have vowel singularities? Well, the set P1 up to PN is a subset of a Markov triple, and I'll tell you what those are in a moment. But in particular, the word triple should be a hint that there's only three things in a Markov triple, so in particular n is less than or equal to 3. So you can't have more than three of these Lagrangians at the same time. In particular, you can't have more than three vowel singularities in the degeneration of CP2. But it tells you a lot more, because it somehow, the restriction of being a Markov number is pretty strong restriction, isn't this? I'll tell you what a Markov number is, and then maybe it'll become clear. So there's another piece of information I should probably tell you as well, which is, what about the Qs? Right, I mean, there's the Ps and the Qs, and I haven't told you what the Qs are. So moreover, QI is plus or minus, it doesn't matter, 3 PJ over PK mod PI. And this is kind of a, so here, J and K are different, IJ and K are different. So if you've thought about Markov numbers, this is kind of a useful quantity to think about while you're studying Markov numbers. So it crops up a lot in that study, but it also arises very naturally here. Okay, so are there any questions before I tell you what a Markov number is? Okay, so a Markov number. Well, let's say a Markov triple. Is a triple ABC and positive integers such that A squared plus B squared plus C squared is 3ABC. Which looks like a kind of random equation if you've never seen it before. But it has it's got very nice properties. So first nice property, which is not at all obvious for Diophantine equations like this, is it actually has a solution. Right, can anyone see a solution? Well, okay, this is... I mean, you know, natural numbers not zero. Anyone see a non-trivial solution? Okay, well, yes. Okay, so there's this solution. Okay, and then the nice observation is that this... you can rewrite this equation as a squared plus b squared is 3ab minus c times c. And so looking at this, you can think this is really a quadratic equation in C. Right? I mean, it's also a quadratic equation in A and B, but in particular it's a quadratic equation in C. And the constant term is this a squared plus b squared. And the constant term, remember, in a quadratic is the product of the roots, and one of the roots is C, so the other root would have to be this one. So if ever you find a solution ABC, then there's another solution which is AB, 3AB minus C. Okay, so can anyone now tell me another solution of this equation?
1, 1, 2.
1, 1, 2. Okay, so you take this guy and replace it with 3 times 1 times 1 minus 1. And if that was too fast, you can check this is a solution. Quite a lot of time. Okay, so this is called a mutation. And the amazing thing about this equation is it has infinitely many solutions, and they're all related by this process of mutation. So let's just do a couple more, because it'll be handy. So what's the next one? Let's suppose I... mutate on this number now. What do I get?
Five.
Five, right. So 3 times 1 times 2 is 6, minus 1 is 5. So 1, 2, 5 is another solution. Now I've got two choices, right? I could either mutate on the... I should say if I now mutate on the 5, I'm just going to go back because a quadratic equation only has two roots. So I've got to pick one of the other ones to mutate on. So what happens if I mutate on the 2? Say again?
No, I can't.
So I get 3 times 1 times 5, which is 15, minus 2 is 13. So I get 1, 5, 13. And if I mutated on the 1, I'd get... Come on, I'm at the IAS, surely. We can do this. 29, very good. So I get 2, 5, 29. And then I keep going, and I get this infinite trivalent tree going out with solutions. And I claim this is all the solutions if I keep going. Okay. So this theorem is saying if I have 3 disjoint pinwheels, then the P's are somewhere on this list. As in, I can, you know, maybe I can find an L2 something, an L5 something, an L29 something. But I can't find, for example, an L2 something, an L15 something, and an L13 something, because those numbers are in different Markov triples.
Is you interested in the Markov numbers or the Markov triples?
Well, both. I mean, yeah, both. So, first of all, yeah, let's sort of go through this and just see what it means for the Lagrangians. So, in particular, not all numbers are Markov numbers, right? So, here's Y. From this equation, you can see that if C is a Markov number, then any odd factor of it divides a sum of squares.
So, Markov number is one of the coordinates.
Second, sorry?
You didn't define a Markov
number. Oh, I didn't. Okay, so a Markov number is one of the numbers on this list. So here we have triples, and every element of one of these triples is a Markov number. I should have said that. Okay, so if C is one of the numbers in one of these Markov triples, a Markov number, any odd factor of it is going to divide a sum of squares, which means that it has to be what? Again, I'm at the IAS, surely.
Congruent to 114.
It has to be congruent to 114. Okay, so any odd factor of C is congruent to 114. By thinking about Gaussian integers. So, in particular, this tells us that L3 something, L7 something, L11 something, these do not occur inside CP2. As Lagrangian.
Well, if you're at Markov, they vary spots.
Oh, absolutely. But this is just a kind of, this is infinitely many examples of things that are not Markov numbers, but as you say, there really aren't very many of them. As you can see, that, you know, they're getting very big very quickly. So. Right. And, yeah, as I said, L13... So I claim L13-2 is contained inside CP2, and L29-7 is also contained inside CP2. But because 29 and 13 don't sit inside the same Markov triple, these two Lagrangians can't be disjoined from one another, so there's some sort of Fleur-theoretic rigidity, you know, stopping them from being displaced from one another. Okay, so any Hamiltonian deformation, you can't move these guys away from one another. Okay, are there any questions about this?
So are there Markov triples that you can't realise?
No, so that's the next thing I'm going to say. So I should also say, any Markov triple can be realised. But I will say that now. Yeah, are there any other questions about this theorem I just rubbed off? Or Markov numbers?
Does it relate to the work by Renata?
Yes. Yeah. That, again, that's on the next slide. Yeah, so the point is, this is not sort of coming from nowhere. This is inspired by a result in algebraic geometry. Remember, I told you that this, if you could classify the degenerations of CP2 that had vowel singularities, maybe you would guess this theorem, and that's, you know, how it works. So, the thing is, algebraic geometers already knew the algebraic degenerations of CP2. So this is the theorem of Hacking and Prokhorov, which is that, let me say it in two parts. So the first part, I guess, I don't know if it's due to them or not, but it's certainly true. So so for any Markov triple, there is a degeneration of CP2. To a toric algebraic surface, which is just a weighted projective space. What should I call this triple? ABC.
There's also work about exceptional vector bundles at this.
Yeah, absolutely, and I'm sure that's related in some way, but I don't know how exactly.
Which came up with Markov?
Yeah. There's
two Russians.
You know, I would really like to understand how that correspondence works, and I thought maybe something to do with mirror symmetry, but, you know, it's somehow relating vector bundles on CP2 to Lagrangians in CP2, so it's not completely clear where mirror symmetry would be coming in to do that. So I don't know. Maybe someone else knows. Okay, so any Markov triple, there is a degeneration of CP2 to some toric algebraic surface with, you know, with vowel singularities modelled on C2 mod gamma A something, etc. Okay, so we have three singularities. The picture of the toric Mohn polytope is something like this. It's got these three singular points. So that's one part of the theorem, but the more important part is that actually this is everything. So in fact, any Hugo Ehrenstein degeneration of CP2, so there's some family of varieties over C, where the general fibre is like a CP2, and then it develops some singularities. Zero has fiber over zero equal to CP2 ABC for some Markov triple.
So what's the assumption on the total space of X?
It has to be Q Gorenstein, which basically means that the canonical bundle behaves well in this family. So, for example, the square of the first Chern class for the singular thing is the same as the square of the first Chern class for the...
So that's not just about the central fiber, it's about the whole family.
That's about the whole family, yeah. It's a Q-Gorenstein degeneration, it's the whole degeneration. So this is saying, actually, you can find pinwheels for every Markov triple because there are degenerations with these singularities, and... if you're just interested in algebraic degenerations, those are the only Lagrangians you expect to find. So from this point of view, our theorem is not too surprising, but it's also an indication that this algebraic geometric result is really sort of symplectic in nature. You can prove it just using symplectic methods.
Is X somehow like a quotient of the trivial family?
Second, that.
Is the curly X a quotient of a trivial family?
That's not how I've seen it constructed, but maybe you can think of it that way. No? Okay. No. Unequivocally,
no. Is the degeneration actually toric?
No.
And that's not true.
I think not. Maybe it is. So if this didn't have a Q here, it was just Gorenstein, then there's this Altman work about classifying smoothings of toric Gorenstein things. And in that case, the total space is actually toric.
That's a local Altman.
Yeah, I don't know. Anyway, I don't know the answer to your question, but... he says no. So. Okay, so you asked about Renato's tori. The relationship is that in this toric vibration, there's one torus which is monotone, and if I transport that into a nearby smooth fiber, I get one of Renato's tori associated to these Markov triples. So the pictures are exactly the same. The source of the Markov numbers is exactly the same. Okay, yeah, any other questions about this?
Do you get all of the combinations of Qs?
So that's a good question. Yeah, so, well, Q is determined by the triple.
I thought there were several possibilities for Q.
Well, no, there aren't. So the Q was plus or minus 3 Pi over Pj, Pj over Pk mod Pi. And is this what you think about multiple possibilities, plus or minus?
I think so.
Yeah, so the plus or minus doesn't actually affect the pinwheel at all. So the BPQ is the same symplectically as BP minus Q. And so, mod P, this is minus Q. So, yeah, I didn't actually say this, but the sign is not important.
Is there any...
I have no idea. So they're disjoint for one thing, but you might imagine if you could make sense of these things as objects in the Foucault category or something, then with coefficients mod p or something, then maybe Renato's torus will have some missing critical points of its superpotential mod p, and then this thing will suddenly generate that Foucault category. So this actually happens for the Chekhanov torus and RP2. That's the first I rubbed it off, but the 112 example, the central fibers, the Chicanoff torus, and the pinwheel is RP2, and you know, that's exactly what happens. There's the missing critical points of the superpotential. Okay, yeah, any other questions?
Usually Markov numbers come from these Vieta moves that you described. Your proof must involve some moves of that type somewhere, right?
No, actually it doesn't. So the proof goes by writing down... Basically we write down some holomorphic curve, write down the adjunction formula for that curve, and that is the Markov equation. So that's how it works. Let me give the proof. I want to focus on the n equals 1 case. In other words, where we just have one pinwheel. Right, because this theorem said if you have n pinwheels, then it's a subset of a Markov triple. So this is saying if you have one pinwheel, it corresponds to a Markov number. On LPQ.
Yeah, so this is closely related to my old question. So you're saying you're going to come up with Markov numbers without talking about Markov triples?
Correct, yes.
Amazing.
Yeah,
amazing.
So I really wanted... I really wanted this to come up with some sort of proof of the unicity conjecture, but we can't do that. So there's a conjecture that in each of the, you know, in these triples there's a biggest number, and you kind of conjecture.
Well, there's a guy who keeps claiming it, you know.
Is that okay? So
I don't. He keeps on saying he's paid to the annals.
maybe it's true. I
don't
know. So the conjecture is that in each triple, the biggest number determines the other two numbers. This is called the unicity conjecture, or uniqueness conjecture. So, the general has a proof. But it would be really nice if we could come up with symplectic proof. Maybe one day. Okay, so if LPQ is inside CP2, then there exist integers A and B such that P squared plus A squared plus B squared is 3ABP. And here's how the proof goes. So here's CP2, here's your pinwheel, and here's a neighbourhood, this Khodorkovsky neighbourhood. And again, if you don't like thinking about singular Lagrangians, forget about this guy, just think you've got a symplectic embedding of this open set, BPQ. I'm going to call the complement of the open set V. And this is the contact hypersurface sigma PQ. And from the way I've drawn it, maybe you can guess what I'm going to do next. So I'm going to pick some holomorphic, some complex structure J. I'm actually going to have a family of them. And for each J in that family, I'm going to pick some JT holomorphic line. Call it UT. Okay, so I just mean a holomorphic curve in the homology class of a line in CP2. And they always exist, right? The CP2 is full of these things. And I've drawn it here so that it actually passes through this ball. And the reason I know that it has to pass through that ball is that the homology class of the pinwheel actually makes sense in homology of CP2 with the Z mod P coefficients. It's actually going to generate that homology. So it has to intersect a line, which also makes sense in Z mod P homology. The Poincaré pairing is non-degenerate. So LPQ intersect UT is not empty, so that the curve always passes through this subset. So I'm going to stretch the neck. So what that means is I'm going to pick my family of almost complex structures in the following way. It doesn't really matter what it looks like up here or down here, but along this neighbourhood near the sigma PQ, I'm going to make sure that it's translationally invariant in this direction. Okay, and then I'm going to replace that with a longer region where it's translationally invariant and then a longer one So that's what this T parameter is. It's telling me how big a region I'm making it translationally in the narrative. So JT is a neck stretching family. You can think what I'm doing is I'm pulling the manifold apart, and what I'm left with is bigger two pieces. Well, maybe more, but I'll only draw two of them. So this is V with an infinite symplectic end attached going downwards, and this is BPQ with an infinite symplectic end attached going upwards. And in between you might have some levels that look like sigma PQ times R, but I'm not really going to worry about those. So the point of this is that if you have an x-stretching family and a family of holomorphic curves along that family, then you can extract a limit using the SFT compactness theorem. This Bourgeois, Eliasberg, Hofer, Wisowski, and Zander result. And what you get in the limit is some kind of punctured holomorphic curves in V bar, in the symplectization, and in BPQ bar as well. That you can think of as gluing together to give you the line you started with. I guess the first place I know this from is from your early papers. Is that where it comes from?
Sounds familiar.
Yeah. As you're in the audience, I thought I'd point it out. Okay, so right. Okay, so I have these punctured holomorphic curves, and I'm just going to throw away everything except what's in V bar. So there's some holomorphic curves here. These are asymptotic to rayed orbits in the contact type hypersurface. But I don't care about that either, because I'm going to I'm going to crush this contact type hypersurface down to a point, and sort of one point compactify this V bar. And I can actually do this, and it makes sense because. Something I didn't tell you, which was that I'm picking J in a very particular way near this contact type hypersurface. So here's how I'm doing it. Remember, my singularity looked like C2 modulo a finite group, cyclic group. And inside this I have S3 modulo a finite group. And this is the contact type hypersurface sigma BQ. And so in a neighbourhood of this I have this nice integrable compact structure on C2. Now that's the complex structure I'm using, and it's translationally invariant, so you can just use this one. So when I glue in this point here, what I'm really doing is just making this neighbourhood look like a neighbourhood of zero in this orbifold. So this is an orbifold point, a symplectic orbifold. And these curves, these holomorphic curves, are just orbifold curves. Taking the one-point compactifications of those two. Okay, but we have tools for dealing with orbifold curves. And they allow us to prove the following proposition. So one of the components SFT limit is an orbifold sphere with one orbifold point with isotropy Z mod V squared, living in a moduli space of virtual dimension, and I'm going to write complex virtual dimension 1. Now this should not be so surprising, because I started with a line, and there's lots and lots of lines, so I could vary the line by picking point constraints differently, and in the limit I'll get lots and lots of these overfold curves, and in particular one of them's going to move in some family.
Saying actually carrying this through, since you use very particular hypersurface and so on, so there are, I mean, a priori one might say that there are certain transversality issues and could potentially occur. So, but you can,
true.
You have to say in some sense it's generic enough that the procedure gives what you expect.
You don't need to worry too much about that in this case. So certainly some of these SFT components are going to be multiply covered.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, because we only care about the existence of something, we can just pass for the underlying simple thing and look at that guy. So, yeah, okay, you're going to have to worry about picking J generically.
Index things, like if
yes.
something is negative index, bubbles off, then certain things might be too high dimension.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you might potentially lose some control.
Yes, I agree.
So the question is how much you have to control, and that of course, tells you how careful you have to be.
Of course, there are some subtleties in this, but somehow it's relatively standard, because it's just in a four-dimensional setting, and we're only really interested in the simple underlying curves in this problem. So, but yes, I agree. Okay. So, moreover, this is not quite enough. Well, let me. Just say, in a neighbourhood of the overfold point, I can lift to the cover C2 instead of C2 modulo group, and this curve is now just an honest holomorphic curve in C2 because J is integrable there. And holomorphic curves locally in coordinates look like sort of Z to the something, and then maybe a power series like this, so that in some local coordinates on the C2, your holomorphic curve looks like this for some Qs and Rs. So the claim is that Q is a square, R1 is a square, and these are going to be the where the other Markov numbers come from. So I should say here, GCD of Q and R is 1, the first of these R coefficients. So what you can think of is you've got this overfold thing and this overfold curve, and as this overfold curve goes to the overfold point, you know it's asymptotic to a rabe orbit, but it's asymptotic in a very particular way. It looks like the cone on the a squared b squared torus knot in S3. Well, let's say.
So viewing this as a curve in some overfold and so on is maybe just nice presentation, but it should before, so you have this hypersurface, it has some rape dynamics, it picks out a particular periodic orbit, and you have Condit-Zehnder indices, you have to go to topology. Out of that, then the answer is the Markov number comes.
Yes, exactly. So the Q should basically be the winding number of this around the rabe orbit, and the R should be. I never quite know how to say this, but it's something to do with the asymptotic operator and how this thing is rotating as you move towards the rabe orbit. So you could phrase all of this just using SFT and like Seefring theory, but it's just easier for us to say orbifolds. Just because we have this very nice singularity. Okay. So
then coming back to what you said before, so that in a triple the biggest number determines the other. So you wanted to get it out of
forget it.
Sometimes there are surprises, even for number zeros.
No, but I mean
I always wanted to write a paper, the symplectic geometry of the integers.
It would be very nice, but I don't see any way to actually get at this.
So what's missing? I mean, what?
Well,
I mean,
too complicated to assemble things, or is there a hunch of...
Well, it's really
the
fact
is
that...
Yes.
You finish your proof and explain where the equation comes from.
Okay.
A squared and B squared.
Brilliant.
Where's C?
So,
C is the
P of the Markov, the pinwheel we started with.
But how does it come from this?
Right, so let me tell you. Okay, so the point is that we basically look at the orbifolder junction formula for this holomorphic curve, and that will turn into the Markov equation. So I just need to say a couple of things first. So there exists a class E in the second cohomology of this orbifold. I'm going to call it X hat. So X is CP2, X hat is this orbifold. This is the rational homology, such that E squared is 1 over P squared. So you see, when you work with orbifolds, you can do all these kind of things. You have rational numbers as like intersection numbers. And this generates a copy of Z in this orbifold homology, which is precisely the Z you get by taking curves with boundary on the hypersurface and crushing that to a point. Right, so this is some relative homology group over Z. So for each relative homology class, you get some sort of Z inside the rational homology of the order field. So in particular, all of our holomorphic curves, let's call our component C. This is going to be homologous to D times a class, times this class, where D is an integer. In particular, the first chain class of this order field is also going to be, well, it's going to be 3p times e. This is basically because the first chain class of CP2 is 3 times a hyperplane, and then that becomes 3 times p times e, because p times e is an integer class, right? So its square is 1. So you should think of PE is the hyperplane class in CP2. Okay, so what does the adjunction formula say? Well, usually it says C1 times the curve is C1 of the normal bundle, which is C dot C, plus the Euler characteristic, plus or minus some corrections, coming from the singularities of the curve. So here this is 3 times P times D times E squared. This is D squared over B squared. This, well, it's a sphere, so it has Euler characteristic 2. But it's an orbifold sphere, so there's a correction term to this as well. Because it's got one orbifold point with isotropy 1 over isotropy p squared. And then there's a correction term coming from the singularity, and in terms of these q's and p's, this correction term is q minus 1 r1 minus 1 over p squared. Pretty much out of time. So let me just quickly say, so this means that 3PD, sorry, that's hard to read, 3PD is, sorry, D squared minus 3PD plus P squared minus QR plus Q plus R equals 0. And now it's possible to prove that D squared is QR. So you prove this by looking at the intersection of this orbifold curve with a small push-off. Remember, it moves in a moduli space of virtual dimension 1. So it has some push-off, and that intersects the orbifold curve at the orbifold point. That allows you to prove that D squared is actually QR. Right, the homological intersection is some contribution from the orbifold point. So these two cancel. This also tells you if Q and R are co-prime, then they both have to be squares. So that's where this a squared and b squared come from, and d is ab. So this becomes a squared, this becomes b squared, and this becomes 3pab. So now that's the Markov equation. So b squared plus a squared plus b squared is 3ab. Okay, so that's how you get at these Markov numbers. Okay, so I'm going to finish that. Thank you.